You will feel a churn in your stomach and know there will be no oxygen mass dropping down. Because hey, isn't this all in your mind? And you will know that the panic attack has arrived.
So Ray is my spoken word boy name. My parents gave me the name Rachna. And I actually hate the word defining, but I would call myself a mix of things. I'm a social impact specialist. I have also run my own enterprise in the past in the social sector. And apart from that, I also do spoken word poetry and a lot of writing.
How long do I have? So I'm on point. So I got into the mental health sector after I did my master's at TISS, and you know, I used to be in a relationship with someone with a mental illness, and I always had friends around me. So, I mean, if I look back at my childhood, I've had moments where I've self-harmed, I've had moments where I've just felt very unable to handle myself, and I felt very unstable. But I never thought it would manifest into a full-blown illness or anything, right? So at April this year, I got diagnosed with 2-3 different things. I mean, it's a mix of depression and anxiety, and she thought a few of my symptoms were BPD. Although I actually disagree, because I started talking to her about polyamory and exploring my sexuality, and I think somewhere that has been misconstrued. But anyway, the anxiety and the depression, she was quite point on.
So back in 2013, when I was about 23 years old, I first felt really out of control with my emotions. The trigger was a breakup, and it happened so suddenly, and I was in shock because I didn't see it coming, and the way I responded to it was really bad. I mean, I was very obsessive in my behavior as far as trying to call the person goes, and I was pretty shocked at how intensely I was responding in a negative way. And because I studied in Tata Institute and I majored in mental health, I mean, I considered taking therapy. First time I went to therapy, I underwent cognitive behavior therapy. So that really helped me manage my emotions for the time being. So until I navigated through the breakup and just completely accepting it, the effects of the therapy lasted till about then. But then after that, my next major breakdown has been in this year, in April. And I think again, I think relationships have just been my doom.
I'm Swati. I live in Delhi with 2 cats and 2 flatmates. I work with an NGO in the field of diversity and inclusion. I'm a lawyer by training, and we are trying to change the legal profession and make it more diverse. I have bipolar and I have fibromyalgia. And since I have these invisible illnesses and mental health disorders, I know the challenges that come with it. So I'm spending a lot of time in creating awareness about it and dispelling prejudices about it and trying to provide support to other people having the same conditions. I was a kid, must have been around 9 years old, when my parents had to go somewhere. So they left me and my brother with an adult, okay, who was supposed to take care of us and look after us. And he was supposed to teach us how to fly the kite. And so basically that day, all the boys learned how to fly the kite, but it was a difficult date for me and a painful memory because he sexually assaulted me. And I didn't say anything about it because he made me feel that it was my fault. And I think I just became quieter and more introverted and less confident about myself. I never learned how to fly a kite. I don't know still, and I don't want to. I grew up very insecure because I would constantly not feel safe anywhere and I would constantly not feel that I belong. Right from when I was a kid, I had depression and anxiety. I just didn't recognize that I need to get help for a long time. I went to a neurologist for migraine, for headache, and she saw that I needed to go to a counselor. When I went to a counselor, I was first diagnosed with depression and I was given antidepressants, but that pushed me into hypomania, which is a really happy, happy, excited stage. Then we realized that I have bipolar, and that's when the whole journey started of understanding it and treating it.
Think of the word vulnerable. Say it out loud. Feel the word on your skin and your being. Vulnerable. How does it make you feel now?
Hey, you guys. I just wanted to talk to somebody, so I just, like, my anxiety attacks didn't end in the cab, and I had a breakdown at my work meeting with a NGO partner, and it was just a bit embarrassing. And the thing is, it's triggering me because I also am still working on my piece about how my anxiety manifests, and I'm just, you know, the more I experience it, the more I want to write about it, but it also keeps me in this groove that I'm trying to get out of. So yeah, I don't know. I'm just gonna go home and try and meditate and figure this out.
I finally got down to writing about my anxiety attack yesterday when I was having the attack. Here goes. This is called Panic Attack 101. Step 1, signs of arrival. You will feel a churn in your stomach. Don't dismiss it for a hunger pang. The air pressure will drop around you. And no, there will be no oxygen mask dropping down, not even if you're on board a flight and the claustrophobia there is getting to you, because hey, don't they just tell you that it's always just in your mind? And your fingers will reach your phone as you frantically try distracting yourself with just about any image or piece of information. And so as you scroll down your Facebook timeline, you find this effort quite counterproductive, because now that feeling has traveled from your stomach to your chest, and you finally know that the panic attack has arrived.
I started the medication. My anxiety levels came down significantly. I must say that. My moods were swinging much lesser. I was lesser, you know, edgy and jittery all the time. And I was mostly feeling quite good. But since I'm a writer, and, you know, writers usually feed off extreme emotions to create, be it intense happiness or sadness, I just felt, you know, like my graph was just straight. Emotionally, I just felt like I was so stable and constant that there was no fluctuation, and I was not used to being like that. And I felt like somewhere, by killing my anxiety, this also somewhere was killing my fire in some way and my ability to, you know, just emote. And I really missed that.
Good evening, class.
I'm Professor, and there's nothing or no one I can't do.
I'm Professor Panani, and our resemblance is uncanny. This is not your run-of-the-mill myology class. No need to copy out diagrams and stamp labels on everything just to pass.
This isn't that math class where you were scored on how quick you get to that one right answer. It's more like languages class. All that counts is the magic you create with your hands and the way you roll your tongue. This isn't your history written by Mr.
As a 28-year-old unmarried woman in India, there's just too much to keep up with as far as expectations of people is concerned. Where every other time you go to a wedding or you go to a family gathering, everybody wants to know when you're going to get married next. And luckily for me, my parents don't put that kind of pressure on me. For most part, it doesn't bother me. But I think somewhere at the back of your head, when you're, you know, when you have the anxiety and you're constantly questioning yourself, somewhere I think these voices do get heard in your own head at some point.
For me, relationships have never been a support system. They have been something that I had to deal with in therapy because they affected my mental health, because I will feel anxious because my partner has gone away for a week and is not responding to calls and messages. These things can spiral me down to an episode. So for me, relationships can be a trigger. I don't know whether it logically makes sense to be in a relationship for me, but it's something that I need. My life, the way it is good, but I feel a part of it is missing and I want someone. Increasingly, I started to, you know, put myself out there and go for these events where you can go and meet other people who would be interested in dating. Last year, I finally got the strength to go on and try and date. And I went to online dating apps, and I think it's been overall terrible for me. But that's not, you know, dissuading anyone. I don't know if I should say this at all. But it's been terrible for me because twice has happened that I've really liked someone and that person says they've really liked me. And it seemed like, you know, like right here, this grade. And then something will happen which I couldn't have predicted and it crashed straight down. And this is so bad when you're bipolar to either be in that high of a relationship or in that of low of a relationship instead of having like a stable, normal thing, you know, like you don't need like roses and balloons. And I mean, it's okay if somebody is just ready to meet you once in a while and ready to listen to you. The person I've dated after having bipolar would often say things like, I think that would be your response, Not that that would be a normal response. A lot of concerns I would have or emotions I feel over something that is negative. He would blame them on the mental health problem, which is difficult. Like, somebody's response might be colored by having really strict, you know, family background. Similarly, my response is colored by a mental health problem. So, but it's still as justified as anybody else's response.
People start mistaking being alone for being lonely, right? So, say I'm single and I am social, I am meeting people, I am, you know, going on dates or whatever it is, I am intimate, but do I really at that point have to forcefully have someone fill that space of a partner in my life? I feel like there is that constant pressure to constantly justify to yourself and others that, hey, I have someone too, you know, I have someone. It's always someone, right? It's, if you say it's a few, then it's a joke. You know, I don't confine to identifying as straight, and I have dated women before, and I do identify as bisexual. And somehow, whether or not I have a mental illness, my understanding of relationships have always been very fluid. When I was younger, I thought of it in a certain way. As I grew older, I realized that if it's not coming naturally to me to be with one person, consistently, maybe that's just not who I am. I'm not saying that I've settled at that identity. I could very well tomorrow meet someone that seems enough, you know. It is harder, of course, to openly be polyamorous in India. I think that polyamory is misunderstood a lot. It's misunderstood for being slutty or it's misunderstood for being selfish. When actually, if you really were polyamorous, it would be the most egoless way of loving, where you're happy to share someone, knowing well that, you know, other people will desire them and they will desire the people, and the same works for you. And as long as you're honest about how you're feeling, it's fine. So, but it's really hard to be that. And I've struggled to be that. I've mostly just ended up cheating on people because it just seemed like the easier way out. Because it's so hard to justify to someone why you would need more than one lover, right?
I know I have had sometimes some phases of hypersexuality. Like I can think of 3 phases, and that led to an increase of online dating for me for some time, like to put it mildly. But I think that my moral standards and my expectations from myself for what is right will be stronger than the urges. Like I'm on a bipolar support group on Facebook. And that's a worldwide support group. And this is one of the most frequent questions on it. Like, do you end up cheating during mania? Do you end up cheating during mania? And that is a tough thing to handle. When I say that, you know, people don't understand mental health, what I'm saying is that at times, they actually hate mental health disorder. It's threatening for them when I am owning my own mental health condition. They expect that I would hide it. They expect that they would be able to make me feel small about it, or I'll be apologetic for my actions and for my mental health disorder. And when I'm not, it sparks them.
I have broken into a million little pieces of myself, scattered disproportionately, like shattered mosaic tiles. I corrode into smaller specks of me, and I'm left unnamed, untamed, unashamed, until there is nothing left of me to break anymore.
Why is there this need to like categorize people as abnormal, who is normal and who decides normal, and you know, questioning just the need for a state of normalcy, right? So to be honest, for me, I don't really give a shit about the label as much as I give a shit about me being comfortable in my skin and be healthy mentally and physically. I feel like somewhere it's about that balance. So I've just been consciously going back to myself and my relationship with myself. I feel like we don't realize that intimacy has to start with the self, irrespective of whether or not I'm in a relationship or not.
Phoenix is a mythical creature that burns to ashes and then rises from them again, rejuvenated many and many times. And after I went through a lot in my life, it's become more personal to me. So, I know every time I go down into anxiety and depression, and every time I'm in hypomania, or every time, you know, life throws a punch, I have gotten back up after so much, and I will be able to get back again.
Initially, when I was on the meds, because you're taking something physical, you feel like, okay, I'm eating this, I should be fixed. Whereas when I went to the Dalai Lama lecture and I met this monk there, and he told me something so beautiful, and he's like, the focus shouldn't be fixing, it should be about healing, you know? So I think healing is the new word that I'm trying to focus on, and you know, the new idea that yeah, okay, like, I've gone through a lot and I think a lot of what I'm going through may or may not be in my control, but how do I, like, heal from it and not be so caught up on the idea of just waking up one day and being completely fixed, because that might really not happen, right?
When you realize that nothing or nobody is actually helping, turn to yourself and breathe. Even if your mind tells you this is futile, breathe. Even if you don't see the point, breathe. Even if you think this will be your last, breathe. And remember that tomorrow, when you feel like this all over again, you are truly the only rescue worker you will ever really need.